Welcome, students. My name is Manajyoti Malakar. I welcome you all to the daily Assam Tribune analysis video. Today we are going to discuss the Assam Tribune of 31st July 2020. This analysis video is made based on the new pattern of APSC Combined Competitive Examination. However, this video will also be useful for other state level government examinations. The PDF file can be obtained from the WhatsApp number provided in the description. Thereby, I request every aspirant to join the WhatsApp group to get regular free materials. So let us move ahead. In this video, we are going to discuss the following topics which are taken from the Assam Tribune. We are also going to discuss the editorial from the Assam Tribune of 31st July. So beginning with the first topic, states prime wildlife habitats given to Coal India for open cast mining. This topic will come under the paper 6 of the new pattern of APSC, that is General Studies on Assam Biodiversity and Environment. Now, this news has been regularly appearing in the newspapers regarding the negative impact on the forests and wildlife in the Dehing Patkai area. Now, one more observation has come to notice is that the wildlife habitats have been given to the Coal India for further mining. Now, conservationists have questioned the rationale behind allotting such biodiversity-rich forests for highly destructive open-cast mining. Also, the site where open-cast mining permission have been given is the Lekhapani Reserve Forest, which forms part of Dehing Patkai Reserve. Now, one question may be asked here, that what is open cast mining? Now, APSC may give a preliminary question, MCQ based question, saying that given the following points for open cast mining, choose the correct options. So there it can be asked in from prelims point of view. Also from mains point of view, they may ask for a 10 marks or a 15 marks questions. Like what is open cast mining and what are its drawbacks. So this topic is important to understand from exam point of view. Now coming to open cast mining. Open cast mining is a surface mining technique of extracting rock or minerals from the earth by their removal from an open pit or burrow. Now in this open cast mining, no long tunnels are made. This form of mining are only used where the resources or the deposits are found near the surface. So where there is only a thin layer of material which can be removed and the resources can be extracted. In contrast to open cast mining, there is also one type of mining which is frequently mentioned in news. So that type of mining I have covered in today's quiz. So I would request every aspirant to go through today's quiz also. The Lekhapani Reserve Forest, which forms the part of Dehing Patkai Forest, also moves ahead or stretches ahead to the state of Arunachal Pradesh. So this region is not only limited to Assam, but it also extends to our neighboring states. Now the forests in the study area support rich wildlife and many Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 mammals, butterflies and threatened orchids. We know that the Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 provisions are given by the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Now under Schedule 1 and Schedule 2, the mammals which come under Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 are given more protection, and offenses under these are prescribed with the highest penalties as per the act. So in prelims also, they may ask what are the Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 animals. or what are the salient features of Wildlife Protection Act? Because APSC will ask questions which are based on the organization structure of forest management, because many questions have raised regarding the forest management of Assam and India. So APSC may check our awareness regarding the various acts and provisions of forest. Now coming to the second question, here the topic is the report on clause 6, government silence irks panel member. Now as we know, recently in January or in February, a high powered committee was set up to study the implementation of the Assam Accords clause 6, which relates to the protection of the Assamese identity. The committee recently submitted its report. Now the recommendations of the committee formed by the Union Home Ministry for implementation of clause 6 of the Assam Accord was put forward to the government. However, the government has not responded yet. Now a question may come in exam, like what is the clause 6 of Assam Accord? Now here we find mention that the clause 6 of Assam Accord states constitutional, legislative and administrative safeguards as may be appropriate shall be provided to protect, preserve and promote the cultural, social, linguistic identity and heritage of the Assamese people. Now this clause 6 is part of the Assam Accord. Now if we may look here, the Assam Accord was a memorandum of settlement between the representatives of the government of India and the leaders of the Assam movement in New Delhi on 15 August 1985. The accord brought an end to the Assam agitation and paved the way for the leaders of the agitation to form a political party and form a government in the state of Assam. As per the accord, those Bangladeshis who came between 1966 and 1971 will be barred from voting for 10 years. The accord also mentions that the international borders will be sealed and all persons who crossed over from Bangladesh after 1971 are to be deported. The accord mentions many provisions, and though after signing the accord, the agitation came to an end, however, some of the key clauses are yet to be implemented, which has kept some of the issues festering. Now, APSC will definitely may ask, write a short note on the Assam Accord or what are the various clauses of Assam Accord. So I would request every aspirant to have short note ready regarding what is Assam Accord, what are the key provisions. Now coming to the next topic, Australia and USA reaffirm loyalty to Quad consultations. Now the Quad is a grouping of country of four nations. So this topic will come under the General Studies 2 paper, International Relations. The USA and Australia have reaffirmed their commitment to the Quad consultations with India and Japan, stressing that they are working side by side with other partners to maintain a secure, prosperous and rules-based Indo-Pacific amidst the rising China. Chinese presence have increased by manifold in last few decades, and to counter that, four nations have come together to form an alliance, and the four countries are represented by India, Japan, Australia and the USA. It was set up with an aim to ensure peace and stability in the Indo-Pacific region and also at the same time check China's increasing efforts to expand military influence in the region. So here we can see the four nations of the Quad groups, namely India, Australia, USA and Japan. Now coming to the next topic, noted Lepcha folk artist passes away. This topic will come under General Studies 1 Culture. Padma Shri Sonam Tesering Lepcha, a celebrated folk musician, composer and lyricist, passed away at Kalimpong in West Bengal today at the age of 92. Prime Minister Modi has condoled the passing away of Lepcha. He was the first from the Lepcha tribe to perform for the All India Radio. He was credited with the revival of Lepcha culture, and he has over 400 folk songs, 102 folk dances and 10 dance dramas to his credit. He has won numerous awards and honors, including the Padma Shri. Now, APSC may check our awareness of various communities residing in the Northeast. So, as the Lepcha community are primarily based from Sikkim, so APSC may ask a question that from which state the Lepcha community belongs to. So, a similar question we have framed in today's quiz. So, I would request every aspirant to go through that quiz also. Now, coming to the next topic, government steps will boost domestic bamboo industries in big way. Donor Minister, this topic will come under General Studies on Assam and under that Economic Development. Now, recently, the decisions of the central government to ban import of finished products and raising the import duty by 25% on raw bamboo items have been welcomed. The measures will help the bamboo industries, including agarbatti making in a big way. The central government has amended the century-old Forest Act, and by that doing so, the bamboo has been taken out of the purview of the Forest Act in order to enhance livelihood opportunities through bamboo so that it can be grown commercially. The donor minister urged the Cane and Bamboo Technology Center to explore setting up of vocational training and skill development centers for bamboo sector for its full exploitation, branding, packaging and marketing in India and abroad. CBTC, that is the Cane and Bamboo Technology Center, in coordination with National Bamboo Mission, will work in this direction to boost the bamboo economy in the Northeast region. The skills will propel bamboo industry with new startups and also enhance livelihood opportunities. It will create more employment opportunities also. The bamboo sector can be a main pillar of ecological, medicinal, paper and building sectors in India. The bamboo sector will be one of the important components of India's post-COVID economy and a vital pillar of the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan in the northeastern region. Now coming to the next topic, SIDBI and TransUnion Civil joins hand. This topic will come under General Studies 3, Economic Development. SIDBI, the Small Industries Development Bank of India, has associated with TransUnion Civil to launch a comprehensive financial education and knowledge platform for micro, small and medium enterprises, that is the MSMEs. The one-stop portal, the one-stop knowledge portal MSME Saksham will guide MSMEs seeking seamless and quick access to finance and will also support them in managing their credit obligations. Small Industries Development Bank of India was set up on 2nd April 1990 under an Act of Indian Parliament. It acts as the principal financial institution for promotion, financing and development of the micro, small and medium enterprise sector, as well as for coordination of functions of institution. So here APSC may ask regarding the Small Industries Development Bank of India, regarding its functions, its chairman, because every year APSC asks one or two questions regarding the chairman of SIDBI or the governor of RBI, the chairman of State Bank, or even the various regulatory commissions and regulatory bodies, the chiefs and the chairman's name may be noted down because these points are regularly checked by APSC. Here we also see that the TransUnion CIBIL is an organization which provides accurate and comprehensive picture of data and information. So TransUnion CIBIL's customers in India include some of the top banks, NBFCs and insurance firms in the country. Now here, as it is mentioned, SIDBI's chairman and managing director Mohammed Mustafa. So this may be noted aspirants, because APSC frequently asks this type of questions. Now, here the chairman and managing director has said the portal aims to guide MSMEs across their credit lifecycle, from availing credit to start and grow their businesses, to manage credit lines, to sustain and build commercial structural strength of the businesses, as well as ensuring timely closures and renewals of credit facilities. It will have a consolidated list of all the schemes launched by the center and state governments for MSMEs. It will be a knowledge hub with informative articles, business insights to help entrepreneurs and business owners start or grow businesses. Now, coming to the editorial part, it is a very important editorial from our APSC mains preparation and also to some extent prelims perspective. So let us move ahead. This topic will be covered under General Studies 2 paper, International Relations. So coming to the background, recently, Iran and China had forged an economic and strategic partnership that would entail a massive $400 billion Chinese investment in energy, transport, and many other sectors. There would be a significant Chinese presence in banking, telecommunication, ports, roads, railways, and other key sectors of Iran. In return, China would receive a regular supply of Iranian heavily discounted oil for the next 25 years. Now, these arrangements are between two countries. These arrangements are not directly targeted at India. However, the latest development is a matter of concern for India, and this editorial discusses how it affects India. Now, it is mentioned here that it is a bilateral matter of two differently surplus countries. Iran has an energy surplus and China has a revenue reserve surplus. So directly, this agreement does not affect India. However, as per this editorial, the author argues that this arrangement has an impact on India. So moving ahead, we will see here the Chabahar port and various trade routes. Now, the Chabahar port is important for India on many grounds. First, it provides us direct access to Iran, which is a resource surplus country, and India is a resource deficit country. So that is one aspect. Another aspect is, in order to move to Afghanistan, we can bypass Pakistan and move to Afghanistan through Iran. So that is another help from the Chabahar port. Another help from Chabahar port is that we can directly go to the Central Asia through this port, as it is called NSTC route. So the Chabahar port is not only an energy port for us, but it also a strategically important location for India. Now, moving ahead, the various agreements between Iran and China have implications for India. The agreement was reached without any public fanfare. It tells about a deepening military cooperation, suggesting a strong Chinese foothold in the oil-rich region. It also indicates that there would be a joint military training and exercises, collaboration in research and weapon production, and intelligence sharing on important issues of common interests, such as terrorism, drug and human trafficking, and cross-border crimes. The most notable is that, by default, China will step in the development of Chabahar port and the construction of the proposed Iranian railway connecting with Afghanistan and other Central Asian countries, involving billion-dollar investments in investments. India, Iran, and Afghanistan signed a trilateral pact to develop the Chabahar port as a historic step towards road, rail, and sea transport connectivity, which was expected to ensure strategic and trade relations among the partner countries. So before this agreement between Iran and China, India, Iran, and Afghanistan signed a trilateral pact to develop the Chabahar port. However, the port is strategically located in the southeast region of Iran, northwest of Indian Ocean and northeast of the Oman Sea. Now, here we can see in the map, the Chabahar port is mentioned here. So the trilateral agreement between Iran, India and Afghanistan was signed in 2016 and it paved the way for building a transport and trade corridor that could reduce half the time and cost of India's trade with Central Asia and Europe. Once the port was fully developed, India would get easy access not only to Afghanistan and Iran, but also to go beyond with the international north-south transport corridor. As we have seen in the map, the blue line is the north-south transport corridor route because it moves directly to the heart of Central Asia through the Chabahar port. So here we can see that the fully developed port will give India an easy access not only to Afghanistan and Iran, but also to go beyond with the international north-south transport corridor to Central Asia, in addition to countering expanding Chinese influence in the region. It was expected that once the port was commissioned, India would not only get an advantage in this deep sea port, but also in developing the Iranian road and railway network, in addition to securing a 10-year lease to build and operate two terminals and five berths, access to the Chabahar Free Trade Zone, and the opportunity to build the 628-kilometer rail line from Chabahar to Zahedan, just across the border from Afghanistan. So Chabahar is in Iran and Zahedan is in Afghanistan. So this rail line will connect between Iran and Afghanistan. It is believed that the US pressure on India not to buy Iranian oil and not to assist Iran in any development sector was too strong for India to ignore. India had to choose between Trump and Rouhani. Several appeals from Tehran to honor the terms and conditions of 2016 MOU, including the last one made by Iranian Foreign Minister Javed Zarif during his visit to New Delhi in January 2020, went unheeded. So what is wrong is that India has virtually given up the Chabahar project despite the geostrategic position of the port. It is not merely a symbolic matter of India-Iran friendship, but an issue of India's connectivity with Central Asia and Russia through maritime trade and energy supplies bypassing Pakistan. China has improved its relationship with Russia in recent years. Now Iran has joined this new undeclared arrangement between China, Iran and Russia bloc. Now we can see that the three countries, China, Iran and Russia, they are authoritative in nature. They are not democratic countries. So secondly, the implication of this arrangement means that China has already constructed several ports on the Indian Ocean, creating a chain of network of refueling facilities and resupply stations from the South China Sea to the Suez Canal. All are said to be commercial, but could be easily used for military purposes because of its rapidly expanding naval power. Thirdly, China has a well-fortified military base in Djibouti, very close to the American base there, apparently intended to participate in the anti-piracy operation off the coast of Somalia, but having naval firepower capacity. Fourth, two ports, Hambantota in Sri Lanka and Gwadar in Pakistan, developed by China in the proximity of Indian maritime belt, deserve attention. So all these points, ports which have been mentioned here, Djibouti, Hambantota, Hambantota in Sri Lanka, Gwadar in Pakistan, Sitwe in Myanmar, and Chittagong in Bangladesh, these are together named as or termed as the string of pearls because they engulf Indian Ocean like a string. So this, as per the author, this deserves attention from Indian government. Till now, there is no Chinese military presence there, but no one can prevent it from stationing troops there and building heavily fortified military installations. Therefore, there is no reason for us to be complacent. Now the author mentions we allowed Iran to move closer to China, which is extremely disturbing. Equally disturbing is we have forgotten our commitment to strengthen the regional network of a strategic relationship. In this process, we have ignored the importance of sovereign autonomy in deciding international trade and diplomacy. Now, coming to the next topic of the editorial, it discusses the new education policy. This topic will come under the General Studies 2 paper, Governance and Social Justice. The new education policy, NEP, was launched on July 29. This policy aims to overhaul the country's education system. The NEP has the laudable objective of making India a global knowledge superpower by bringing in structural and other changes in what by now has become a moribund and obsolete system, the draft of which was prepared by a panel of experts led by former Indian Space Research Organization Chief K. Kasturi Ranjan. In school education, the existing 10+2 structure will be modified to 5+3+3+4 structure covering 3 to 18 years old, where the first 3 years would be formative play, school years of nursery and kindergarten. Curriculum content will be reduced in each subject to its core essentials, the stress being laid on key concepts, ideas, applications, problem solving, critical thinking, and more holistic inquiry-based, discovery-based, discussion-based, and analysis-based learning. So these are the objectives of the new policy. The three language formula will continue at the school level. The languages to be the choices of the states, as long as at least two of the three languages are native to India. Pertinently, more focus would be laid on vocational studies, the aim being to ensure that at least 50% of the students to the school and higher education system will have exposure to vocational education. In the case of higher education too, there would be flexibility of subjects which students can take up in both major and minor disciplines regardless of the combinations that exist now. Such a change, eliminating the prevalent arts, commerce, and science streams, is expected to benefit those who are interested in multidisciplinary courses. The government is also planning to introduce undergraduate programs of 3 and 4 years and postgraduate programs of 1 and 2 years and a provision for multiple entry or exit in the system, while the MPhil degree would be discontinued as per the new policy. Strengthening the technological aspect in studies, introduction of e-courses in regional languages, developing virtual labs, and creation of National Educational Technology Forum also form crucial components of the NEP. For board examination, there will be objective and subjective papers which will allow the students to be judged on the basis of their learning. While the 4-year multidisciplinary bachelor's program will be the preferred option, a system of appropriate certifications, a certificate after completing 1 year in a discipline or field, including vocational and professional areas, or a diploma after 2 years of study, or a bachelor's degree after a 3-year program will be introduced. The new policy also renames the Ministry of Human Resource Development to the Ministry of Education. So, aspirants, this was the discussion of the Assam Tribune of 31st July 2020. I hope you found this discussion very useful, and the various points which I have made regarding prelims perspective and mains perspective, students should prepare them very carefully. Thank you.